Let's find out what stories our North America Bureau is pursuing right now from our correspondent, Henny Espinosa.
Hey guys, here are news making headlines for Filipinos in North America.
We begin in Irvine, California, where the police are looking for a car with a license plate that reads Bastos, accusing the driver, now suspect, of Bastos or lewd acts. The Irvine Police Department has issued a wanted poster for 58-year-old Robert De La Cruz of Tustin, California. De La Cruz, a counselor and caretaker at a day program for adults with disabilities, is accused of sexually assaulting his patient and coercing her into sex acts from June 2022 until March of this year. Police have executed a search warrant in his home and found additional evidence. However, they have been unable to find the suspect. Police, who believe De La Cruz is Filipino, says that he is known to drive a blue Toyota FJ Cruiser with a license plate that reads Bastos 2. Those with information on his whereabouts are asked to contact Detective Craig Vores at 949-724-7131 or email through cvores@cityofirvine.org. Meanwhile, if you are a San Francisco Bay Area resident and you take public transportation, you may qualify for a massive discount on fares. The Metropolitan Transportation Commission and Bay Area Transit agencies have expanded the Clipper Start pilot program, which provides transit fare discounts for lower-income adults ages 19 to 64, to now include VTA buses and light rail trains, and to include a uniform 50% discounts for rides on all systems that take the Clipper for fare payment. There are no costs to apply or be part of the Clipper program. After riders tap their Clipper Start card, they immediately receive 50% of the single ride fare if they're eligible. To qualify, you must be a resident of the San Francisco Bay Area, be 19 to 64 years old, not have an RTC Clipper card for people with disabilities, have a household income of 200% of the federal poverty level or less. For more information, visit clipperstartcard.com. And finally, let's check out Cine Film Fest, the very first Filipino film festival in Canada. The event, which will roll out the red carpet on April 13th and 14th at the prestigious Hotel X in Toronto, was organized by the Cine Institute in partnership with ABS-CBN International to showcase the best of Filipino talents in the world of cinema.
The Cine Institute kasi is a non-for-profit organization that we created to allow for collaboration between emerging and established creative people to do projects that are meant for creatives, whether it be in the arts, theater, not just film, but anything that promotes creative endeavors.
ABS-CBN's heart and soul is really in storytelling. So this aligns with our mission of bringing the Filipino content to the world stage.
Open to all, the festival will feature a carefully curated selection of 10 feature films and 7 short films.
And those are the news making headlines today. You can catch more TFC News on the ABS-CBN News website, YouTube channel, and app. I'm Henny Espinosa. Back to you guys at the rundown.
Hamas leader Ismail Haniyeh denies his sons, who were killed in an Israeli strike Wednesday, were fighters in the group's armed wing. But when asked whether their deaths would impact ceasefire talks, Haniyeh says the interests of the Palestinian people are placed ahead of everything. He adds they are still seeking a deal, but Israel has been evading a response to their demands. The killing of Haniyeh's sons was coordinated by Israel's military and intelligence service, without consulting top commanders or political leaders, an action seen to complicate efforts to free hostages still held in Gaza. Israel bracing for possible retaliation for the killing of a senior general and six other Iranian officers in an airstrike in Damascus on April 1st. Israel's military spokesman says civilians were not being told to make any special preparations, but adds Israel is highly prepared for a range of scenarios. Most Israeli troops have been pulled out of Gaza in preparation for an assault on the southern city of Rafah, where more than a million Palestinians are sheltering. But fighting continues in various areas of the enclave. The U.S. remains concerned about the risk of escalation in the Middle East following threats made by Iran towards Israel. The U.S. State Department says Secretary of State Antony Blinken has asked counterparts in Turkey, China, and Saudi Arabia to use their influence to stop Iran from attacking Israel.
We continue to be concerned about the risk of escalation in the Middle East, something we have been working to mitigate and contain since the attacks of October 7th, and specifically about the threats made in recent days by Iran against the state of Israel and the Israeli people. We have been engaged in a series of contacts, not just at his level, but at other levels too, to talk to foreign counterparts to send this very clear message to Iran that they should not escalate this conflict.
Russia also calling on all countries in the Middle East to show restraint and prevent the region from slipping into chaos. The Kremlin says there has been no requests for Russia to mediate between Israel and Iran, but it notes the Damascus strike was a violation of all the principles of international law. American football star and actor O.J. Simpson, who was acquitted in 1995 of murdering his former wife, has died at the age of 76 after a battle with cancer. Simpson was one of the best and most popular athletes of the late 1960s and the 1970s. He parlayed his football stardom into a career as a sportscaster, advertising pitchman, and a Hollywood actor. But things took a turn after Nicole Brown Simpson and her friend Ron Goldman were found fatally stabbed outside her Los Angeles home in June of 1994. Considered the prime suspect, Simpson was cleared by a Los Angeles jury in what U.S. media called the trial of the century. But he was found responsible for her death in a civil suit and later imprisoned for armed robbery and kidnapping.
And it's kind of tragic and sad. And, you know, for such a talented guy, and he was a lovely guy when he was at SC and, you know, previous to that. So whatever happened with the drugs and the relationship and, you know, the trial and everything else, it's just kind of a sad, tragic end to his life, which could have been so much more.
Not going to miss him.
How do you think the wife?
I don't have any personal animus to him, but I just think I don't have any hatred toward him, but I think he murdered his wife and he got away with it.